Hello, coffee drinkers. Super excited. I'm in my listening chair, and in the background, not that I can play you too much of this stuff, but in the background, I'm listening to the master of the duo album I made with John Davis about 6 or 7 months ago. He just sent it to me. Man, it sounds really good. I think he mastered it over at MasterDisc, maybe, Scott Hall. I think that happened today, and we already got the masters back. So, great mood to start today's vlog in. Now I gotta listen to the whole thing, check it all out, and figure out how and when we're gonna release it. We're talking about doing a gig in New York City, maybe around the 23rd, 24th, something like that, of October. Be nice to do an album launch for this. So, New York, October. Give me some feedback. People gonna be around? Okay, the master sounds awesome. It sounds like some, I was just talking to John about it. We were texting back and forth. I said it sounds like some high quality, like early ECM production type level. And I said, it's amazing what you can do when you get two good musicians, some tape. Remember tape, they come on big discs. And they have very limited amounts of space on them. Yes, we recorded the whole thing live to tape. So it's amazing what you can do with two good musicians, a little bit of tape, and a really good mastering session. Now I'm really excited, and I wish it wasn't October until we were planning to release this. But all good, just means there's a really nice project coming out in October that I get to share with you guys. And I already thought it was a great thing to be a part of, but now that I've just heard the master, I'm just totally, totally psyched. So stay tuned for that in towards the end of October. And I'm working really hard on VBL right now and the lessons and all that stuff, and like going through archive footage, and there are just so many things that I haven't been able to get up on the site, and I'm looking through videos that I've saved and clinics and performances and all of these things and interviews and stuff that I want to get up for the members. And I came across this, it was kind of daunting at the time when I did it. It was a couple of years ago now, and it was being part of a clinic, giving a clinic, you know, being part of a clinic with John Patitucci, Victor Wooten, Steve Bailey, Doug Wimbish, and Gary Willis, and myself. Those were like the six bass players on the panel, on the clinic panel. It was at Berklee College of Music, and it was, like I said, almost 2 years ago. And I'm uploading the whole thing for my members at VBL, but I thought I would give you guys on the vlog a sneak peek at that and share some of it with you. I had like 1,000 different places I could have gone with the vlog today, but this came up. I thought it was really cool. Just awesome to see that many great musicians on the stage. Just they happen to be all bass players. That's kind of, to me, a little bit inconsequential. Everyone on that stage is a really great musician. It was a great honor to be a part of it as well, and to be able to discuss music. I mean, obviously we were all answering questions, but to be able to discuss music and learn from all of those guys at the same time was really a lot of fun. And I'm kind of really psyched to share it with you guys. So this is from October of 2015, from Berklee College of Music, with John Patitucci, Victor Wooten, Steve Bailey, Doug Wimbish, Gary Willis, and myself.
I have to honestly, I have to care like hell up until the downbeat, which means I have to prepare myself every opportunity. I have to get better, improve, to learn, to live life well up until the downbeat. As soon as it's a downbeat, you have to stop caring. You can't give a shit, all right? The reason that is because it's a trap. Because if you really care and want to have an experience and have, so suppose you have a good gig where everything's happening, the audience is happening, have a great response, all right? If you try to relive that on the next gig, then you're gonna start, it's gonna start compromising being in the moment. You're gonna compromise your decision. You're gonna revert to, oh, I'm gonna play the idea that worked last time. And you're not gonna be creative, you're not gonna be in the moment, and you're gonna be trying to live up to something that could maybe impossible to happen because of acoustics, because of the crowd is tired, you know. If you try to keep possessing these moments, it ain't gonna happen. So you have to not care. And that's a big contradiction, to be sitting up here and just like not care what happens. And that liberates you to create and be in the moment, and amazing things can happen.
Quick exercise for you to do next time you play it. It's better if you can play, do it with a couple of friends. Next time you play, because we're always trying to play our best, just for fun, play your worst. Literally, just say, look, let's see who can play the worst. but you see how you're laughing? That's what it does to you.
That's great.
You let it go, right? See how bad you can play. Almost every time your friends are gonna look at you like, wow, that was incredible, right? And then go back to playing and you'll realize how good you actually are. But we're always trying to strive for that next thing where our brain is. Where our brain is always ahead of our ability. And we hope that stays the same. You know, we don't want to catch up. But go ahead and allow yourself to play bad. And you'll laugh, the pressure's off, then playing good won't come with so much bad.
One other quick thing, and I know working a lot with Victor, and I can speak for everybody up here. When we come up to play, the game is on, but it doesn't really matter who wins. There's no winner, and no matter what happens, we react to it and we go with it. It's all I've heard you talk about, almost like comedy. But what do they call it?
Improv
comedy, where whatever subject you pick, let's go there. Let's commit to it and let's do it. It magical things happen with that attitude. Now, getting it right is important, but I'm like Gary, man. Those NFL football teams, they spend 6 days studying playbooks, working out, doing all of this, but come game time, they're not thinking about the playbook. They know the plays so well that when they call it, they just do it. They react to whatever changes in the backfield, whatever's coming across the line. Those plays change, and they keep evolving. If they really went strictly by the book, it wouldn't. The end result won't be as good as it is if we just let it happen and react to it.
We
probably have about 15 more minutes.
I heard you about. Can you speak louder just so everybody else can enjoy your question?
So the question is
say louder.
So it's about improvisation.
Okay.
So when you do, we have like a specific center, you know, like a kind of a map on your instrument that you rely on when you do. Because I hear that many times you play like, you know, like wrong notes, you know, but you resolve it so nicely that it makes it really beautiful. So you have a kind of map when you do that. I know about the chromatic approach, but I mean, you don't think too much on that, you just play, right?
Well, first of all, I don't think at all when I'm playing, for sure. There's no thought process, only listening and reacting. The map or the framework you ask about, there is a map and a framework. That's generally something to do with form, I would say, you know, just based on the kind of gigs I do now or on the kind of music I compose and record as an artist or as a band leader. So there is a map in terms of the form of the song, the structure and the harmony of the chords. In terms of what I'm playing melodically, I don't map that out. There are no specific devices that I'm going to use just because it says G minor or just because the chord is G minor. I'm not going to think. First of all, I'm not going to think. And second of all, there's no, oh, well, this shape fits this and that shape fits that, because,
you know, I've spent 20 years with this guy.
Trying not to think. I've spent my entire process trying not to think about it. Listening, transcribing, assimilating information, and then when something, I'm really going to try and speed this process up and force it a little bit. For me, this takes hours and hours and hours, and I hope it can happen in about 30 or 40 seconds. But I'm looking for a mistake. It was the success and failure thing that you were talking about. I wanted to add to that, that every time I pick up the bass, I'm looking for a failure. I'm never looking for a success. Because the only thing I learn from, for me, is from a failure. It's from a technical element, something I'm not proficient at, then I have something to work on. If I went through my whole process and everything was success, I'd get to the end of it in 20 minutes and think, shit, what am I going to do now? You know, I had 6 hours to practice today, and it took me 20 minutes, so I'm always looking for a failure. I know this is G, so I have somewhat of a starting point, and like you said, I play some wrong notes sometimes, and I resolve them, so an element of what I'm playing is tension and release, creating tension and release. Thank you. I want to develop. It took me a second, I played some stuff which could I put in the trash, shift apple delete, but I found the phrase that I wanted to develop, you know. Etc. It didn't take too long for me to find something that I've never played before and something that I could spend the next 3 hours. But I can take that anywhere in the instrument and in any key or any note, it doesn't matter. I can play completely randomly, but my reaction and my ability to listen to what I'm playing and my desire to find something beautiful and find something melodic, or generally, having practiced for 20 years, find something beautiful and something melodic. And then, of course, the idea will change. Like it evolved into four different things, I think, there. You know,
cool.
But it did come from somewhere and was kind of, like I said, I was trying to condense the process. But it does start with me finding a little idea, moving it around the instrument without thinking, oh crap, I can't play E major on G minor.
I think a lot of people, when they play, until they're as comfortable as you, have trouble even hearing the cool things that they're playing.
Absolutely.
Right?
But the process is obviously, to me, was simplicity. And not trying to start transcribing, you know, train playing 26-2, but start transcribing Miles playing like Freddy Freeloader. Everyone can hear that. All that space. Transcribing space and listening to space, that was where to start. Starting simple and understanding that it's okay not to play 1,000 notes all the time.
Okay, I hope you dug that little sneak preview of what all the members are getting at VBL. I thought it was a great vlog material, and hear a little bit from other people and not just that monotony of me and my opinions. Australia and New Zealand still showing up in droves. That's awesome. Some plans developing, so thank you for that. Today's vlog is done. I will see you guys tomorrow.